get cracking.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Dota 2 Champions League. We got game number 2, Avertis Pro versus Fnatic, after what was, good God, one of the largest goal drops I have ever seen. Just straight up with, like, pubs, like, competitive games, it doesn't really matter. Like, that was just, what was it, over 20,000 gold drop in the space of just, like, 2 minutes. All because of one really, really bad team fight for Fnatic, and Virtus Pro managed to take that game. So, it seemed pretty hopeless for them, honestly. I was expecting just the way that Fnatic were controlling the game. I thought they were going to be able to take Roshan. Then they gave up a Roshan. Then they gave up a really bad fight. Continued to fight that fight with buybacks and lost it still. And the result was Virtus Pro able to just do way too much damage to Fnatic and just slowly but surely whittled them down to size. So we're going to be getting into game number 2 now. Fnatic, again, I can't stress enough how close the group stages are for the Dota 2 Champions League. And both of these teams are in the lower bracket here. So neither team is going to be happy if they walk away with a tie. But Virtus Pro, they can get 2 wins off of this one. They'll get themselves up in a better position. They're currently sitting at the 6th place slot, which is still one of those bottom 3 slots that ends up getting you kicked out of the Dota 2 Champions League at the end of the group stage. And they don't have many matches to be played. After this, they still have a match to be played up against Alliance as well as Na'Vi. And those are not going to be easy matches either. So, and of course, seems about that time Valve decided, yeah, just go ahead and randomly kick you out of the game. Thank you, Valve, for that little present you bestow upon me every single solo cast. Every single day that I'm solo casting, I get kicked out. Doesn't happen when I dual cast, just solo cast, because it's like Valve just throwing me the middle finger. It's just like, oh, you enjoying your solo cast? How about you look at the wallpaper for a while? Thanks. Morana and Shadow Demon's going to be the 1-2 for Virtus Pro, Batrider and Skywrath Mage, the 1-2 for Fnatic. And we're also going to be seeing pretty normal bans on both sides for the first 1-2. The second set of bans is where things get a little bit more interesting. Fnatic, for example, banning away both the Silencer as well as the Morphling. Morphling being one of the hard carries that's I would say is still going to be pretty favored. He was favored in the 6.81. When it comes to hard carries, we didn't see too many of them. But Morphling was one of the few. We saw it a few times there in the Chinese scene. And I think that in this current patch that he is a great hard carry solely because of the fact that he's able to be a part of these team fights. But he's also, there's very less likely that you're going to be picked off when you're solo split pushing a lane. And it seems like that's the biggest impact that 6.82 is going to be happening, is that teams will continue to 5-man, but we're going to have a longer stretched out game overall because of the multiple changes. For example, tier 1 towers, refreshing glyphs, we have less bounty coming out of those towers, and then on top of that, we're having these team fights that are riskier to have when you have a high net worth lead. I mean, you saw the way that gold lead just plummeted downwards. That doesn't happen without the comeback mechanics in place. Now, that's not to say that the comeback mechanics are wrong in having Virtus Pro take control of that game after they take Roshan, wipe Fnatic again, basically, because of 2 different buybacks. They killed their 2 carries twice in a row. Got a whole bunch of, like, Beyond Godlike streak goals. I think there was probably 1 or 2 killing sprees in there as well on the side of Fnatic. So they get all of this kill gold plus some tier 3 towers and Raxes. Like, they should be ahead in net worth by that point in time. But that really doesn't happen without the comeback mechanics going into place. But now the Naga Siren going to be picked up for Fnatic, Tidehunter for Virtus Pro. So it seems like they're going to continue to angle for more mid-game team fight. This Morana could be a support Morana. The Shadow Demon is a 1-2 support combo with the Tidehunter being our offlane here. Fnatic can run the Naga Siren however they want. I mean, I can't say that I've seen too much of the Naga Siren support. We were seeing it more in 6.81. I can't really think I've seen it too many times here in 6.82. So it could be a support Naga Siren. I'm leaning towards a core position Naga. Hani loves Naga Siren anyway, so it might be a mid Naga here.
I speak for
We
trees.
Did have a couple of bans from Virtus Pro, though. Fnatic's the Drow Ranger taking that one out of the hands of Fnatic, since they did have such a hard time in the first 40 minutes of the game with that Drow Ranger. And then the Doom being banned away as well. Furion is going to be picked up now by Virtus Pro, and that's pretty interesting just because this means that our Tidehunter is either going to be in the mid position, which is possible. If it's a Naga Siren mid, Tidehunter isn't terrible. He's not great solely because of the fact that Naga Siren has a very, very high starting armor, so Anchor Smash spamming is actually not going to do that much harassment to the Naga Siren, and she's still able to easily get CS when her damage is low from the Anchor Smash through Riptide. So I don't think it's the greatest matchup in the world, but it like Tidehunter will be able to do decently well and get a lot of farm. Magnus now picked up, though, and that is going to be your mid for Fnatic. They've got the offlane bat. Should be a one-position Naga Siren with the Skywrath Mage fulfilling the role of a four- or five-position. Means we're just left with one more support for Fnatic and Virtus Pro, who still need their hard carry. Remaining. So there's different options they could do with this. I mean, there's also the possibility that Furion can be our mid for Virtus Pro, and they still run the Tidehunter in the offlane, though I think that's much less likely. The Furion mid was an old-school Dota 1 strategy and was seen a little bit in 6.81. One or two teams tried it out, but I really don't think it works that well anymore.
Fnatic's turn to
especially with the rune change. Having rune control as your mid actually means a little bit less when there's a guaranteed rune on each side. So it used to be like the Furion with the mid teleporting in and always being able to get himself a rune, barring any support interference, was a good way for you to get control as the mid laner. But with this change, it means much, much less than it did. So Tidehunter for our mid, Mirana could be a one position, though I'm leaning on some sort of hard carry here. They do have a lot of team fights, some decent amount of push thanks to the Furion, but right now we're having Fnatic. They have big, big team fight ultimates. They've got very strong late game.
Virtus Pro's turn.
They're going to be trying to stall this game out. I can't really see that changing. Virtus Pro, they could go for a super, super hard carry here. In fact, the Necrolite was banned away by Fnatic, but they could go for a super hard carry. I still don't think you have the better late game. Like, Tidehunter's good. Magnus is better, though. RP is a similar big team fight ultimate, but then you got the Empower coming into play, which can make a pretty big difference going into late game for your carry.
Ember Spirit.
Fnatic's turn to pick.
Ember Spirit's got to be our last pickup here. So I like that pickup. It's a good, aggressive, early to mid-game oriented hero. You don't want to be going late with this hero, that's for sure. Up against the Naga Siren, Magnus, Batrider. Like, there's too many things to catch you out. Because Ember Spirit, when he goes into late game, he's only late game viability, and he is a good, strong, late game viable hero. But against this specific matchup for Fnatic, they have way too much lockdown for him. And I'm even concerned about some of their early to mid game lockdown. Like, later into the game, when you have level 16 Naga Siren, you've got 60-second cooldown on your ultimate. You're just able to blow it for whatever reason. You can very easily just pop it just to catch out the Ember Spirit and try and grab him with the lasso or silence him up with the Skywrath Mage and control him. It's a really great way to initiate on Ember Spirit. So I don't see that possibility going into late game. In fact, Fnatic are not going to be going for the Naga Siren as a core. It's going to be a support Naga Siren, and we're left with a Phantom Assassin now. For Fnatic, I thought they would have been fine with the one-position Naga, but they feel differently. The only reason I don't like the idea of the Naga Siren as the support here is that I wanted to see something a little bit more active with the Skywrath Mage. You've got a Mirana Shadow Demon for Virtus Pro. That is a very active kill combination that is able to move around the map and make a big difference in lanes. Skywrath Mage and Naga Siren isn't as much. So I'm slightly concerned in that regard that they're not going to have enough early game. They have a lot of mid to late game here. Like the Phantom Assassin, Magnus, Batrider, those are all cores that are only really get strong by like 20 minutes. But usually much, much later than that. Like 30, 35 minutes. But we'll see how it goes. I mean, the laning phase is going to determine a lot here for Virtus Pro. They have to win the laning phase here. They have to walk away with a decent net worth and experience lead, I think. if they want to have a shot, because they don't want to let this game stall out. You can't be going up against a Phantom Assassin going into late game with Empower. Even if Ember Spirit and Furion are strong in the late game, I still feel like the pick-off potential of the Batrider and Magnus and all these other heroes up against, you've got some of the squishiest late game, like glass cannon style heroes, Furion and Ember. So they're going to need to establish their dominance fairly early on. Still, though, what did they pick up, by the way? BZZ, it's actually a one-position Furion. God in... So if we just look at players and where they lane, BZZ is the one position. God is the two, and Seedoy is the offlane. Now, I expected Tidehunter to be run in the mid with Furion off, but it looks like they are actually going to be running a one position Furion and God taking over the mid. It's not that Ember Spirit mid is that odd, it's more like Furion one position is a little bit different, but they don't have their traditional supports. They don't have supports that are going to be hanging around the lane too much, so it's practically going to be a solo lane for BZZ. As the Shatter Demon Mirana combination, I'm sure, is just going to be roaming around constantly. I mean, there's really no reason to run this combination unless you're going to be trying to inflict some very early damage in the first 5 minutes of this game. Early wards being placed down. Tidehunter did get a chance to see this ward being placed. But I doubt they're going to give him counter wards for it. He went for mass amounts of regen. Smartest thing you could do up against a Skywrath Mage who's large mana pool plus relatively low nuke cost. I mean, Arcane Bolt, when you talk about abilities at level 1, level 2, that give you really good mana to damage ratio, Arcane Bolt is one of those ones near the top. I mean, you're talking about 70 mana for about, was it like 100 damage? Not quite, but it's somewhere about like 85 damage after resistance. Illusion. And you could just spam that out over and over and over again. So the problem is he usually forces you out of regen and will completely force you out of lane. But if you bring yourself an extra set of tangos like this, he'll burn through his mana faster than you burn through your health. And you'll just be able to play this pretty aggressively from that point onward. So smart pickup for Seedoy. The defensive trail lane here for Virtus Pro. I'm sure they're going to be roaming around. They've got one set of dust, but they also got a very early set of boots here for Yol. But they did just get spotted out. This smoke gank should be aware. God getting a little bit low, but not going to be able to get that one kill. Looks like the ensnare skewer combination kind of scaring him out. They shouldn't actually get the opportunity. God getting low actually will be dying here before the supports could come in. Looks like they tried to bait that one out a little bit, but they're not even going to get the opportunity for an arrow. And Fnatic start out with a really great kill on the Ember Spirit. I mean, this is perfect. Ember Spirit, the best way to be able to exploit the Ember Spirit is usually with the level 1 and level 2, where Flame Guard really doesn't protect you from much magic damage at all. And they managed to pick up a first blood this early. Arise may be picked off, though. He's able to get himself away from the arrow in time. Still has a skewer ready to go. Let's bring him back into the tower range. He's going to be right-clicked down, but the slow is enough to keep God out of range. And the nuke as well. He's going to die. Couldn't even potion up, and God dies two times in a row in the first 2 minutes of the game. Pretty rough times. First. Oh, dear. And now we've got Arise, who's going to find himself a regen rune, too. Yeah. So now when God comes in, this is going to be the problem. Batrider actually managed to get the Furion kill there. And not even losing much for it. He didn't even have to dive. The problem with the Ember Spirit coming back into this lane is he's going to pop Flame Guard, and it's going to be instantly lost with one Shockwave. Does 150 damage. Your Flame Guard only blocks out 50. Even at level 2, it's only blocking out 200. So you can actually get in two different shockwaves and still get a good chunk of damage on him.
The prize is mine.
Ace is actually, I think Ace is one of those players who's pretty, hold up, you old Jotam. They land the arrow here. It looks like Ryze should be dying. So nice little pick off by them. Rotations around, working out a little bit better. It seems like Sito has been doing an excellent job in his offlane as well. Just the couple times we've clicked down here, he's been able to deal with the Skywrath Mage's harassment by spamming out tangos, and is also being able to play aggressive enough that he's actually picked up 14 CS in 3 minutes. And if Hani is left alone here up against this Tidehunter, he's going to have a tough time getting CS against that Anchor Smash damage reduction. It is a little bit, it did get a little bit of a nerf, which it needed to. It not only does, it actually scales the damage reduction from level 1 to 4, so it starts out at 45%. But losing 45% of your damage this early on, still very tough to get last hits. Skewer back into the tower. God has nothing he can do. Another ensnare-skewer combination, and at this point, Ryze is going to hit level 6 before our Ember Spirit is able to hit level 5. Anyway, Ace is one of those players that is, I think, not many people really look at him too often. But he's a really great player, and he's Batrider, man. Batrider is fierce. Fierce as all hell. Sidoi is going to be slowed down and should be able to pick up this kill as the Skewer lands. And Sidoi will take a long time dying here, but he should die eventually with the Shockwave coming into play. And Ryze will lose no time going up to the top lane. Jotam is now going to be caught out by the Batrider. They already got the kill on the Naga Siren, and the leap away will get him away. Ace, though, is now going to turn on a BZZ. Was able to get rid of those sticky napalm stacks, but it seems like it's not going to matter as the arrow lands on Ace, but still not enough to save him. Ace, though, maybe going down here. Jotam's a bit low. Ace going to turn around, get a couple right clicks, and does finish off the Mirana before he dies to the Shatter Demon. So trades off on both sides. RP goes down. God trying to protect himself. Skewer back. Flame Guard still going through. And he actually may be able to survive getting blocked up a bit too much. Come with me. One step ahead. Arrow lands. And the bottle. God will turn this around and actually gets the kill onto the Naga Siren. Or at least helps the Jotam get it. Now jump in for Ryze as well. Ryze will also fall. BZZ and Jotam rotating into the middle lane just at the perfect time to help out their Ember Spirit, who's been having such a rough time with the rotations of the Naga Siren. Has now made a full recovery, though, after being part of those two kills. Now has this level 6. Ryze just wanted one more pickoff on that guy. Just one more with the first RP. And once you get the Ember Spirit to level 6, you're unlikely to kill him, as that ensnare combination does nothing. But if they could have just gotten one more kill, that would have been perfect, and they would have been happy with the way they shut down the Ember Spirit in the laning phase and know that, hey, he's not getting his face boots drums for a long time. But unfortunately, Virtus Pro returning some fire and now being able to get the Ember Spirit up to level 6, even if he didn't get the kill for either one of those, just being a part of it meant a lot for him. Come With Me is probably going to die here. He's a bit tankier than most other supports, so he'll live for a while, but the Furion ultimate makes a big difference, especially when you've got a level 2 Soul Catcher. Hani, meanwhile, is just seems to be never in lane at this point. Because what could he do? He's up against this Anchor Smash that is now 55% damage reduction. Good harassment. And is probably his best option, just rotate to the top lane. He actually rotated to the middle lane. But looks like he's going to be walking top. Meanwhile, Virtus Pro were kind of setting up a attempted gank underneath the tower, but not going to be finding anything. Instead, it might be Ember Spirit who's going down with the slow plus the silence coming in and just barely getting the jump away. Ryze had to have been so close to getting that pickoff.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
Stealing some of the Batrider's farm. They're now going to try and go for the kill. They don't realize Ryze is here. And he's going to be going for Yol, it looks like. He's got the skewer ready to go. No reason to use it just yet. Use the RP on him. And now skewer down into the clip, plus the shockwave will be able to finish him off. Not sure if that RP was totally necessary. Jotam is now going to be caught by the ensnare, plus the silence, and couldn't even leap away in time.
I am sorry I hurt you, creature. Not your right.
Virtus Pro will just have to back themselves up and content with a tier 1 tower. Which still, it means Sidoy is going to have a very fast Blink Dagger. He's already got his Arcane Boots. Considering the fact he was going up against a dual lane, this Blink Dagger timing is pretty impressive. Speaking of which, Arise is also going to have his.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
He's already got 6 kills by 8 minutes. As he rotates to the bottom lane, they're going to give Naga Siren some time to farm up mid. You kind of want to have your Song of Siren and maxed out Riptide. And depending on how you're using your Naga Siren, doesn't seem like they're actually trying to farm her up too much. But Naga Siren with maxed out mirror images can get a lot of extra farm from the jungle as well. But oftentimes it requires you to have Arcane Boots or at least a bottle to keep up that kind of mana cost, and you do need to spend some serious time farming up before you do so. Fade's Boots not even finished up by God. I mean, just comparing the two mids. You've got Ember Spirit, 2,700 net worth. Arise, 4,300 on his Magnus. I mean, this guy has a world-renowned Magnus player. So it's no surprise he did well, but thanks to Come With Me's constant rotations in with the ensnare setups, did way better than you ever really should as a Magnus. So Blink Dagger's coming up for everybody here. Batrider's going to have his. Do we have any other Blink Dagger heroes? No. Phase Boots were grabbed by Hani. Looks like he's going to be going for the Ring of Akilla, Phase, and Drums build that we saw from last game. Virtus Pro continuing to focus on objectives here. Looks like they tried to actually try and pick off the Naga Siren real quickly with this mid rotation, but still, it looks like they should be able to take this tower. Seems like Fnatic, I mean, we know their laning phase is kind of weak, and Virtus Pro are pushing so early on that Fnatic just are not ready for these kind of pushes. Maybe when they have a Blink Dagger for the Magnus, which is up right now, and a Blink Dagger for the Batrider, they have a better shot of being able to initiate those team fights. But for now, Sidoy just makes a huge difference.
Tower is under attack.
I mean, no Blink Daggers, plus you're going to be fighting into a Ravage when your team doesn't even have that many nukes to throw into a team fight. It's a pointless risk.
Pull roots and run.
Blade Mail build for BZZ. Standard stuff. How are Jotam and Yol are actually keeping some distance levels. Level 4, level 5 by 9.5 minutes in isn't too bad. Oh, big critical. Big critical, and honestly, if you're not careful, if you're God, like, just the constant little harassment of the dagger is enough, but if Hani actually jumps in and somehow gets, you know, something amazing like a double critical before you jump away, hate life. Ace is going to be caught out by the disruption arrow combination, but unfortunately with no Blink Dagger on Sidoy, won't be able to jump him. Silence on God, and the skewer back as well into a dagger plus the shockwave. Good rotation from Arise. They're continuing to lose towers, but they're also continuing to shut down the Ember Spirit. I mean, this guy is going to be like a non-factor going into the mid game at this rate. He's such a low level. Meanwhile, Hani, who was also a little bit shut down in lane, but not nearly as much as the Ember Spirit. You want to compare these two hard carries. He's a full 1,000 gold ahead and possibly even more. Silence in, God taken out by the Riptide.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Bottom Arise, disrupt it up, arrow flies out, and blink away. Nicely played by Arise. It'll actually skewer back in for Yul, gets the shockwave as well. And the Naga Siren Sleep, it'll stop BZZ. Looks like they want a little bit more though with Jotam. Now they bounce back to BZZ. He already teleported in, so they know he is kind of done for. And they'll let Hani clean up that last hit.
Something in your eye.
He can actually grab a full set of drums here pretty soon. Pretty significant exchange there. Batrider actually managed to grab Jotam, pulling him back, but I'm not sure what he thought was going to happen with that one. Maybe he thought Arise was going to be close enough for the blink skewer back, but that wasn't the case. Anyway, you have to be careful on the side of Virtus Pro. I mean, think about where their net worth is coming in. And this is why you're not going to be seeing any, like, five-man death ball 20-minute pushes. Gold for me. Is that the net worth gained, even with the comeback mechanics, like, diminished quite severely. And I think we're sitting at a very good position of where they're at right now. Even with those being diminished. Oh, RP back. Push in. Jotam Sidoi is going to be silenced immediately after he gets that cleanse from his Kraken shell. Very nicely played by Arise. Very good timing. And they'll actually now potentially turn this into a push, though. Looks like they have to defend top first.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Ace will be flying over the mountain looking for somebody. They do have the wards in place to see him coming, though. And BZZ, while he is going to be slowed down by the sticky napalm, it's going to be the Batrider who's in some trouble here. The Furion ultimate is going to bounce around. Ace just straight up gets popped before the rest of Fnatic could respond. And they'll go right back for the push with the Batrider down for 25 seconds and their Tidehunter, who still has his Ravage, reviving and teleporting to the top lane. I think they've easily got enough to take this tier 1 tower. The problem is, with you're never going to see many like five-man death ball pushes, like those Pugna-type pushes that we used to see, because that net worth lead that you gained from towers is actually even riskier than it was before. It was always kind of risky to run those 20-minute push strats like that, but now it becomes even riskier because that one team fight you lose when you try and push uphill becomes even more punishing than it was before, thanks to the extra net worth you gain. You get all this extra, you get this big old giant net worth lead, and then you end up feeding away a lot of extra gold because of that when you do lose a team fight. So those fights become that much more riskier, and that's why you're seeing a lot of these games just kind of draw out oftentimes, despite the fact that teams have these really big leads, is for those exact kind of ideas. So that Virtus Pro, they're not running like a five-man, 20-minute push lineup, that's for sure. But most of the net worth that they've gained has been through taking these towers. While all the net worth that Fnatic has gained has been through kills. So every single time, it's like the net worth ends up playing against Virtus Pro to some extent. A very, very small amount right now. But that X amount of gold that they got from the tower where they actually almost take a lead in net worth ends up playing against them in the next team fight, where they lose and give extra gold to the side of Fnatic. Sleep goes down, Aegis already grabbed though by BZZ. And it doesn't look like we're going to be seeing a full out team fight. Both teams will back up to their respective corners. Well, not God though. God's looking for a fight.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
So the point I'm getting is that Fnatic, not only are they getting a little bit of extra net worth just due to the fact that Virtus Pro may be ahead at one point in time thanks to tower gold, but then they have this tower gold of their own that they're going to be able to get.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Which, once they're strong enough to be able to start taking enough map control to actually start chipping down some of these tier 1 towers, they're still afraid of team fights. They still can't go for the tier 1 tower pushes. But eventually, bit by bit, these tier 1 towers will fall, and that's going to be a huge influx of net worth, even if that did get nerfed down. Tier 1 tower gold got nerfed hard. But that's still going to be not a lot of net worth coming in for them. And you'll see that net worth lead, which has already like been bouncing up and down in favor of Fnatic.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
It's going to become one of those leads that is established. Going to be one of those like 5k plus leads that you hold on to. as long as they're just able to weather the storm for the next 5-10 minutes. Jump in, looks like Arise misses the attempted skewer back. And that's fine. Fnatic tried to pick off, didn't get it. They'll just back up. Meanwhile, Ace is going to try and finish up his Blink Dagger. What's our Phantom Assassin going for, by the way? He actually went for the Ring of Akilla over the... sometimes you could see Ring of Akilla and drums, but instead it seems Hani just wants the Ring of Akilla and is going straight for the BKB after that. Ember Spirit, meanwhile, well, he has drums now. 850 gold. Almost gets caught out by Ace, but was able to get off the chains just in time. Experience lead, slight lead for Fnatic, about a 5,000, 17 minutes in is pretty significant, but of course experience still holds to the comeback mechanics. It bounces up and down much more often than gold does. I mean, that was always the case with team fights. You always get more experience than gold out of team fights anyway, but that becomes even more significant in 6.82. And both teams afraid to push. It's really on Virtus Pro, though, to try and force these team fights. And it looks like that's why they want to go for a smoke pickoff here in the middle lane. Sidoy is going to lose his smoke soon. Arrow comes in, lands on Hani. Ace actually blinking into the side as well. RP on two. And Arise going to pull him back, jot him. Oh, Sidoy actually gets silenced up again. Ryzen does it. Naga Siren Sleep goes out, and Sidoy is going to be in a position here. He's going to have to blink himself away. Still, though, Fnatic got the one pickoff. They end up saving Hani, the Phantom Assassin, who was targeted in the beginning of the team fight. Ryze also going to be able to teleport out successfully. They got the one pickoff on the Mirana, but the biggest play twice in a row in these team fights has been Ryze and his silence. Every single time, they get the RP, they skewer the hero's back, and then right as the Kraken Shell goes off, removes all the debuffs on Sidoy, he immediately silences them up before a Ravage can go down. And that's some pretty tough timing to get. I mean, sure, the silence is instant, but in the chaos of the team fights, even just throwing it a second too early and then having it immediately be debuff like that dramatically changes that team fight. Looks like God is going to go and push out this bottom lane while the rest of his team searches for that opening. They've got a remnant here ready to go.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Fortunately, sieging down these tier 2s is so much tougher than it used to be with the extra 5 armor that they gained with the last patch. Going to be building on to a mech for the Tidehunter. Yul looks like he's going to be picking himself up a possible like Blink Dagger or Force Staff. I wouldn't mind a Blink Dagger just because that RP initiation, he may be needed to save an important key hero like one of the cores. I was going to say just the Ember Spirit, but honestly Ember Spirit is too under-farmed at this point. So Furion actually may be more important than him in some of these team fights. And then the Tidehunter, the possibility of, you know, need to be able to get off your Ravage, making sure he doesn't get popped or anything like that. Ace gonna grab BZZ here, dragging him back and blowing him up with the Skywrath Mage. It's a combination we've seen time and time again, and for a good reason. It's excellent to being able to pick off anybody. I mean, that's just so much magic damage. Even just a level 1 ulti from the Mystic Flare, that's 600 magic damage. Even many tanky heroes can't deal with that.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Greatest thing about this Empower means that Phantom Assassin, I mean, you're already kind of hero that doesn't need too much in damage and just needs to focus more on stats than anything else and survivability.
But that's made even more apparent when you have got an empower on your team. Because that'll give you all the damage you could possibly want for. Is under attack. So BKB to start, possibly Helmet Dominator, follow up. Scotty is, or not Scotty, Vladimir is also not a bad lifesteal pickup on a Phantom Assassin, because it also gives you that damage aura buff, which is pretty big. Jesus. But again, I don't really think the extra damage is needed. Or, okay, Mask of Madness. I think a Mask of Madness is actually a item build that is unnecessarily risky when I feel like Fnatic have a really good hold on this game, both now and going into the late game as well. So I feel like Mask of Madness is a bit unnecessary, but it's a better pickoff item, that's for sure, and you're going to see it right here as they go for Yol. No Mask of Madness required, it was still on cooldown. Now he's going to try and go next up for BZZ, who teleports his way in. Hani is now going to teleport out with his BKB timing. Only thanks to the Sprout was BZZ able to survive there. I think Hani probably, if without the Sprout, he probably would have been able to commit to taking the Furion and still teleport. Arise, what are you going to build from here? Are you going to go for the Battle Magnus, or are you going to go for the Refresher Magnus? Because he's got another 2,000 gold after his Blink Dagger and Force Staff. Trickster's Rune of Illusion. And at this point, you see, come with me. I was talking about how, like, the farming Naga Siren, like a 4 position who makes a good transition into a semi-carry. Well, early on, Come With Me didn't have many options. He was roaming around a lot, and he was getting some decent experience, but he was more dedicated to the support role than anything else. But since this game has really stalled out, he's made a beautiful recovery and farm since then. He's currently sitting at 3,000 gold, 23 minutes in as his support Naga Siren, so he's going to have himself a Radiance pretty soon. And once you have a Radiance on a support Naga Siren, Virtus Pro, they can end the game, but it's going to be so damn tough. Like, normal, like, core Naga Siren, pushing into that when you just have a Radiance, yeah, it's a little rough, but you can still just quickly kill the Illusions, and that's not an issue. The problem is that with a support Naga Siren, you're spending more resources dealing with Illusions and taking more damage over time from a support player than you should be. And then you've got the Phantom Assassin coming into play. Looks like they want to gank up God. They've got the two-man rotation coming in with the Batrider sitting on the side. I don't think they're going to get God, though. He's already jumped his way up, and Ace, unable to get to him in time. Jump in middle lane, looks like Hani should be fine here. He's got a BKB. In fact, he's going to go for a quick kill on BZZ and then trying to make his way out. Moonlight Shadow goes down, and Hani, one last hit, couldn't quite get it. And now Hani has actually overextended himself during his BKB timing, makes a jump away to the Rage Creep, but is still going to be burning out here. And Ember Spirit gets a very important kill there, as that will finish up his Battle Fury. You can start working towards a Crystallis, and it looks like they're also going to take that opportunity to go for Roshan. Oh, refight. Team fight recap, please. Don't disappear on me. I actually wanted to see that. Refresher Magnus it is for Arise. He's already got enough carries between the Phantom Assassin and the Naga Siren, so. Speaking of which, Relic is up for the Naga. One step closer to that Radiance, and one step closer to Virtus Pro getting into a mid-game position where they can't actually push down the base. So I think they need to act fast. The other option is just going into late game, and you don't want to be doing that against a Phantom Assassin Naga Siren. Invis Rune, Rise. or maybe come
Dire's
with me.
Top tower is under attack.
They're, yeah, with Fury and ultimate and a teleport in, they can actually kill come with me pretty quick. Ani Basher should be his next pickup. That Mask of Madness, he has a pretty good chance to stunlock heroes.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Mjolnir is finished by the Nature's Prophet. And Virtus Pro. Surprised they haven't been able to force down any of these tier 2s yet. With the pickoffs that they've been making, I thought they would have been putting in that extra effort. Mass teleports up to the top lane. Looks like Hani was able to find himself a kill on BZZ and will teleport away before the end of that one. Still though, the tier 2 is maybe dropping here. If it does, it's going to be at the exchange in the middle tier 1 tower. Ryze already pushing that one in. Teleport though. And Jotam is going to slow down that push. Ryze just immediately uses the RP. Skewers him back into the silence and gets that pickoff. Goes right back to trying to take that tier 1 tower. God will take that tier 2. Yol kind of baiting him out a little bit here. He's got Seedoi coming in from the side. Sticky Napalm making this pretty rough for them to fight. God is here now, though. Yeah, there's the beginning of the basher for Hani. Ace has got a gem. Plus boots of travel. Jump in, skewer back. Nice blink away, though. Tidehunter probably wouldn't have been in any trouble, but he has no idea what's sitting behind Ryze. They really don't have any vision up at all due to that ward dying. Ace countering some vision means Virtus Pro left map completely dark. And that's why they kind of need to go for something like this. 4 or 5-man smoke gank. That allows them to go into the enemy jungle with confidence and establish some map control, perhaps find a pickoff that is good enough to take a tier 2 or take away the gem from the Batrider. Yol will find his smoke has been popped by Come With Me, who's currently farming up the neutrals. They know what's going on here. And they're going to try and still go for it. Seedoi, Come With Me just immediately pops the ultimate. Nothing really of significance is going to be lost here. Arrow goes out. BZZ actually teleports into this one. Come with me. They can blow the Ravage if they want to try and pick him off or just right-click him down. Yeah, he's so squishy, actually. God dive in a little bit deep. Almost able to finish off Ryze, but not quite enough. Unfortunately for them, that pickoff really doesn't mean much for them. They delay the Radiance, yes. And that's good, but they have the middle lane that's pushing out, top lane that where Hani is pushing that. And their bottom lane is already at their tier 1. So they can't actually turn that into any objectives. They are holding on to a pretty decent gold growth there on both the Furion as well as the Ember Spirit. Unfortunately, the rest of their heroes, not quite as much. Seedoi's building into a Fresher. That's pretty decent for him. The supports, though, well, they're... And they're actually not that bad. Blink Dagger on Yol. You've got a Medallion on Jotun plus another 1,600 gold on him. So I take that back. Their gold growth really hasn't been that bad. This match is fairly even, actually. 2,000 gold lead and about a 6,000 experience lead. I stick by what I said earlier, which I still feel that Fnatic have the better options going into late game. Ember Spirit and Furion, I really don't feel can contest to a Phantom Assassin Naga Siren combination plus Magnus. Like the Magnus empower on this Phantom Assassin. Plus just the possibilities with the Naga Siren ultimate are, I mean, you could be used for a pickoff, delay a really bad team fight, find initiation. There's so many different options to use that Song of Siren. And I think it gives you so many options going into late game that you always have the advantage at that point. Yul's going to be placing one of those Tinker Wards, but this one actually gives them some really good vision. That actually covers the full lane. It's not bad. Most of those kind of cliff wards don't give you enough pertinent information of the lane that they're that useful, but that one's actually pretty good. Ace. He sees enough heroes that he knows he can't go for a pickoff. Meanwhile, we're going to see Hani versus God here in the top lane. Hani just doesn't really care about God. Once he has an Abyssal, though, he'll have enough lockdown for himself. Nice RP usage. And damn. That is a very, very high number very, very early on into this game.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
600 gold. The ninth tower, though, Dire's at least they get that much.
Has been denied.
And may actually be able to find the Phantom Assassin here. BKB wasn't used, though, last time. And now it is. Purge is going to slow him down, and he's just going to have to teleport out. And Ryze, scaring himself downward. They're going to try and keep going. Smoke pop, but with the double blinks on there, Ravage actually being used there. Haven't seen enough Ravages in this game, and it seems like Sido agrees. He's been holding on to Ravage, waiting for better team fights than he's going to find. Ace actually loses. He had his blink dagger for a second, but so come with me now with the Radiance. Begins that road of very rapid farming. Virtus Pro gotta start being concerned about this now. Probably just gonna be waiting on the next Roshan. Gonna be coming up in a few minutes here. God is searching for the Skywrath Mage, rounds the corner, runs right into him, and immediately gets silenced up, loses his Flame Guard here. Going to be taking a lot of damage from the ultimate, and will still be able to get the Skywrath Mage. Flame Break, oh, 19 health left. Come With Me comes in, he actually has his ultimate ready to go, and doesn't actually get it off. Ace is going to die, oh my god, the Mjolnir proc, or the Static Charge proc, I mean. Actually managed to finish him off. If Come With Me was a little bit more liberal with his ultimate use there, I think he could have picked off the Ember Spirit, and they could have just walked away from the Furion there. Still, though, Fnatic, they lost a small fight there, but still get a significant upgrade. Hani has an Abyssal. This means he's no longer reliant on just the Magnus for the pickoff on the Ember Spirit. Same goes with the Furion. He can solo pick those two off by himself. He certainly has enough damage for it. And now has the lockdown for it as well. It's definitely a much needed pickup, though. We have the Scythe of Ice for BZZ. So just keeps on farming away for both teams. I mean, it's a gold and experience lead that doesn't mean anything, and it's just so minimal. So at least you can kind of understand them sitting back and just farming up. Because by this point, it's like, well, nobody has a serious advantage. There's not one team or the other that you're really looking at going, okay, you should be pushing. I feel Virtus Pro should be pushing on Fnatic, but it's not like they're devoid of late game. They've got some great heroes for it. I just feel like Fnatic have a bit better. But we'll see. Virtus Pro, I mean, Refresher, Tidehunter, do some amazing stuff. He may try and jump on Hani here. It's a risk. He's basically just hoping that the BKB doesn't get activated. And Hani actually gonna go for this kill. Teleports away, though. He's getting lower and lower in his BKB timing, so he's got to make sure that if he goes for a kill, he has to try for it for like 2 seconds and then teleport out. If he doesn't get it within those first 2 seconds, then abandon ship. So I guess it's going to come down primarily to initiation. Whether the Magnus is able to find a big empower or a big reverse polarity, or the Batrider with a big lasso and they pick off God. Or if it's going to be our double Ravage. Gives them the game.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
How much was that one kill worth? 800 gold, 2300 experience. Careful there, Jotam. Ani knows what you're up to, man, and he doesn't like it one bit. Ani protects his wards. And they get a gem off of it.
Double damage.
Time to take down these towers. Got two different tier ones staying up that tower is under attack. Don't need to be up anymore. Ani's this big, he can just backdoor him when they've got a couple of pickoffs like this. So tier one goes down, bottom lane still being pushed out enough that they probably won't be rotating to the bottom lane anytime soon. Roshan is up, they're gonna run into the Shatter Demon. Quick little blink away though, it'll be fine. Wonder how much teams are going to start playing around this vision, because this is probably going to be a pretty common ward to be used for Roshan, because it gives you the vision through this pathway, which is huge, because there's still some Direside advantage, and it's being able to utilize this area right here, especially if you can keep control of your tier 1 tower here in the bottom lane.
The rune of invisibility.
The Direside still have a Roshan advantage. The problem is the Direside of old, that Roshan advantage came with your tier 1 middle, tier 1 bottom, and even to some extent your tier 2 bottom tower. Like, your control of the Roshan pit came from those towers. Your control on the Roshan pit from the Dire side with this new map really mainly comes from this tower, somewhat from your tier 2, but that was also pushed back a little bit. And in general, the terrain changes also mean that tower has a little bit less of a hold. But from this advantage right here is where the Direside are still able to control Roshan to some extent. Yul is going to be picked off here. Lasso. Still, though, I mean, if this is at the cost of Roshan, it's well worth it for Virtus Pro. Jotam just ran his way in, though. And that means that Fnatic, they're not going to let you do this so easily. Moonlight Shadow goes out. Oh, BZZ got bashed. Still will be able to get out, though. Or not. BZZ. Oh, God. He's just getting torn apart by Roshan. Ryze, is he going to drop the ultimate? Drops the ultimate. BZZ is going to get skewered back into the rest of the team and gets picked off. This poor guy couldn't actually teleport away. Now Roshan is left with just no health whatsoever. Sidoy is here. They're going to see him now. As Ace runs over him, oh, the ultimate goes out, and now this is not a good position for them whatsoever. Ani, RP goes down, they're going to be able to take down Sidoy, and another jump in, skewer uphill, BZZ, four staff over to the right side. And is going to be Scythe-ified up, will be taken down before he can get off his secondary RP. Very awkward engagement here on this little bit of a cliff. Ryze actually blinking down and skewering that hero back up as the Phantom Assassin jumped down into the pit with Blink Strike. Was an unfortunate series of events that will lead to Virtus Pro claiming Roshan for themselves. Still, though, that was a lot of time where this Naga Siren was pushing out lanes and farming. He's now got himself, he's almost to the full split pushing Naga Siren. Once you have a Manta, that's full split push Naga Siren. Once you get your heart, then your team fight Naga Siren. The only problem with your Naga Siren right now is that you're still extremely squishy. So if you're initiated on, you're done for if they have any sort of disables. And your illusions are still very squishy, so they don't actually last that long in team fights either. Once you have a heart, though, everything changes. You've got mass illusions, and your illusions are just tanky enough to survive through nukes.
and still keep on trucking.
Bottom lane looks like they did find come with me, but oh, the Furan ultimate.
Furan's just like, shut up, shut up, shut up.
Wrath of Nature. Crystalis and soon to be a full up Daedalus for God here in a few minutes. BZZ going to come in with his Scythe of Ice, and Skywrath Mage can't really do much to stop this one. Just silencing up BZZ is the best he can do. He can't really drop the ultimate on him for fear of the Blade Mail. Another objective down. Tier 2, 42 minutes in. Virtus Pro will now try and push uphill a little bit, though. They don't have the double. They don't even have one Ravage, so probably shouldn't be trying for it just yet. Oh yeah, but I wonder how many teams are going to start playing around this, because if you notice, there's a slight gap of vision where you don't actually get seen. This ward is really important, though, because it covers half of this pathway, plus covers all of this pathway, which is how the Direcide control Roshan is through those two entrances.
Double damage.
There's still possibility of being able to work your way around that ward without being spotted out. See all the very, very aggressive vision that is up right now for Fnatic. They're going to go for a pickoff on God, pulling him back right into Hani, who will abyssal him up. And if he gets a critical eventually, he'll take down that Aegis. BZZ gets the Scythe of... Whoa! Zedoy! Drastically overestimating his Blink Dagger. I like that team fight recap. Zero gold change, zero experience change, because all that was lost was Aegis. Right side, we have a Ryze, threatening the RP, looking for a better opportunity. Four staffs in, gets the RP onto the Tidehunter. Now four staff upward, trying to get himself away from BZZ as he's turned into a piglet. BZZ actually almost able to finish off Hani there with a well-timed blade mail. Couldn't quite get it though. God, the rest of them are so squishy that run themselves away. Oh, Ryze gets caught, come with me. He didn't have a boots of travel. That's why he didn't want to stick around. So Skywrath Mage had different ideas. He thought it was going to be, okay, pop ultimate, everybody teleported away. But the problem is, if Naga Siren sticks around that long enough for everybody to teleport away, he doesn't have a TP. And he won't be fast enough to run himself away from the Ember Spirit. So he kind of had to abandon that Skywrath Mage.
Burn away your ignorance.
BKB is going to be up here for Ace. Another significant upgrade for him. Mantis style up for the Naga Siren. We've got another 4K on our Phantom Assassin. I think you build hearts here. I mean, you obviously have enough damage with Empower, so more survivability. Go for a heart, especially since you chose to go Mask of Madness. Don't want to have that Mask of Madness results in you being one shot by some really well timed Ravage sleight of fist combination. Am I missing any other items? I don't think so. Rod of Atos for Ryze. Oh, looks like Ryze is going to be going for a Scythe of Ice. Always worth it when you have a refresher. And he's actually not too far away, so 700 gold. 2 minutes, he'll have it. And that's it, just Daedalus for our Ember Spirits. And can sell something here. I always hate to see drums being sold when it still has charges on it. Apparently God has only used one in the last 20 minutes. And damn, BZZ's got a lot of gold. This guy is, actually, I was looking at that CS and I was going, man, BZZ's got to be way ahead of everybody, but Phantom Assassin is actually almost tied up in CS. You could see they're actually very, very close in net worth as well. Now, MKB is going to be the choice here. Wait, who did I see that on? Furion? Yeah, MKB for the Furion, of course. Oh, yeah, because you're dealing with Phantom Assassin. I was thinking that MKB was on the Radiant side. I was like, why are you getting an MKB on the Radiant side? It's not like your Ember Spirit's going to be building into a Battle Fury ever. But yeah, MKB for the Furion.
Illusion.
Make a very, very big difference for him. Still, though, I mean, when it comes down to these straight-up man fights, Hani will always beat you, and thanks to his both of his lifesteal as well as his Basher. So it's more important for you to be able to inflict as much damage as possible during that Scythe of Ice time. And you kind of have to always use your Scythe of Ice on him. He's just illusions going to town. We were 47 minutes into the game number two of Fnatic versus Virtus Pro. Virtus Pro were able to take game number one after what was a pretty rough game for them, all the way up until like the 45-minute mark where they gained 20,000 gold in the space of 2 minutes. And game number two looking very, very even. I mean, we really haven't seen more than a 4,000 gold lead on either side. We're going to have double hearts coming up here in just a minute for the side of Fnatic. Lost their poor rhinoceros. Not sure if they can really go for a push. Fortunately, the best lane for them to push right now is the one that's actually being constantly pushed out by Come With Me. They still have a tier 2 tower in the top lane, but Virtus Pro, they're not strong enough to push into tier 3s, and that top lane is a bit of a hazard. But yeah, heart for Come With Me, and heart for the Phantom Assassin as well. Though I suppose you could always sell his Mask of Madness in favor of a Satanic, and then get himself a big damage dealing item instead. Still, though, that gigantic increase of attack speed from Mask of Madness may behoove him to keep it. God gonna be caught by the lasso, pulled back in, and with the abyssal and everything else, we'll easily take him down. Now, if they want, they can push much harder in this top lane. With the Naga Siren, like, they sure as hell can actually siege down some of these tier 3 towers, but Come With Me is actually going to be teleporting back. Going to go for his heart first.
Come.
I know a lot of it is the current meta. Oh, BZZ, I'm not sure what you, why you thought this one was going to be a good idea. He actually eats the cheese and is still going to be dying.
Shouldn't have trusted him.
I don't know why he thought he was going to walk away with a win there. Come With Me catches out two heroes here. Both of them will blink away. Oh, wow. That is so unfortunate. Marana actually managed to grab the Batrider there and will immediately die. Tani just leaves the gem. I mean, what is he going to do? There's double gems and wards on the deck. Run, courier. The race of the couriers! Oh. Radiant side is going to win. So, double, those are both aces gems. Okay. And the wards from the Rana as well. Now, finally, a Manta is coming up. Normally, you would see Manta before the heart, but it seems like Come With Me wanted to tank up a little bit before he got that extra farming item.
Dire's middle tower.
Normally, the Manta is picked up before because it's part of your split push, just having those extra illusions on the field. But he's got it now, and now he just needs a butterfly. He's pretty much good.
Dire's bottom tower is
hold on to the gem for now, which means that there's going to be no wards on the map ever. These Naga Siren illusions will just spread all over the place. Counter ward everything. Scythe of Ice? He could pick it up. He wouldn't have a buyback, but he'd still have a little bit of extra gold. Quite surprised he doesn't just get it. He's got a lot of reliable gold. I can understand if he doesn't want to burn through a lot of that reliable gold. If he can keep enough reliable gold to hold on to buyback, so if he can hold on to 1600 gold after buying the Scythe of Ice, he'll be in a really great position because he'll have Scythe of Ice and he'll have a guaranteed buyback no matter what. Well, as long as he doesn't buy anything else. MKB now for the Ember Spirit as well. Double MKBs. BZZ is actually going to be trying to do Roshan while God gets picked up by Hani. And that's no buyback. He just bought an MKB. And if BZZ gets caught doing Roshan, yeah, they have to back out. It's just way too risky. The Naga Siren Illusion revealing them. That means they have to give up this tier 2 in the bottom lane.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Looks like they're going to try and set up for a kill on this Naga Siren. The teleport in from the Furion. Going to be leading this one. Naga Siren gets off the ultimate, though. And will now be fine. Doesn't look like they're going to be able to do much with it. Well, maybe they will. Teleport in from the Phantom Assassin. Immediate Scythe of Ice on him. The Ensnare manages to catch BZZ even with a Force Staff. He's going to be dying here. And Jotun will look to teleport himself away. Gets hit by the Flame Break. Leap down. And Ace will try and keep up with him. They only have Jotun. Even if he does get chased down here, he's far enough away that he's going to delay them so much. Just running past tier 2s. He's got nowhere to go. He might as well just die. Might as well just suicide or die to Hani. Tactically feeding him a godlike spree so they can try and claim that gold back later. Apparently no experience was gained because Phantom Assassin is level 25 and she was the only one in range of that kill. I was looking at that going like, why the hell is that say no experience gained? Well, BZZ, it gets hit by the Abyssal. Good use of the disruption though, and Hani is going to be running out of his BKB timing here. They could blink forward, gets off the Ravage. They need a little bit extra. Ravage number 2 comes in. Hani still very, very tanky. Ryze sitting here with the RP. Doesn't manage to get it off before Hani goes down. And now they're going to try and back themselves up. Buyback already from the Furion, trying to make good of this team fight. Ryze will lose his life here on the right side. We also have Ace trying to get himself away.
Become peace.
And we'll be able to find Ace eventually. So they'll get that pickoff. Yep, they get it. I have to click on this fight recap before it completely disappears. 1,200 gold lost on the side of Fnatic. And 1,900 gold gained by Virtus Pro. And a pretty big experience jump as well. But that is also a buyback burnt by the Furion, where the Phantom Assassin will continue to hold on to his. Obviously, it's well worth it if they can get Roshan. But they're trying to do it up against a Naga Siren. One of the worst heroes to try and do Roshan against. The illusions are going to start making their way into the pit. And if he's quick on it, if he sees it right now, he can actually get off the ultimate. Yep, there he is. He's in a great position now. Just going to hold off. Now the ultimate gets popped. And he starts trying to threaten some of these heroes. He's actually going to teleport out. And I thought he was just going to be able to push them out. But by that commitment of the ultimate there, I think he just got a little bit scared of the purge. But with him teleporting away, they'll get both the Aegis as well as the Cheese. Aegis for God, BZZ for Cheese. Let's see. Virtus Pro, they're putting this late game to the test. I said Naga, Siren, and Phantom Assassin with a Magnus. Should be better late game. And I do believe they still have an advantage, but a lot of this is just going to come down to the initiation. Virtus Pro have this really good teamfight initiation with the double Ravage and the Sleight of Fist being able to eat through everyone. Plus, they have that instant punishing mechanism with the Furion, who's just been caught out by X. So if Furion was alive and they won a team fight, he could actually immediately punish Fnatic by teleporting to the lane that's pushed the farthest in and go straight for those buildings. Or the immediate buyback and teleport in. Like, those two ideas about the Furion are what make him strong in the late game. But Fnatic have the possibilities. Again, the Naga Siren sleep very, very versatile ability when it comes to the late game. Every minute you've got the opportunity to either disengage, engage, delay somehow, and go for like just taking down a building or something like that. Bottom tower is under attack. You've got always the split push, usually going to be on your side at this point, at least in one lane, if not multiple, if not all of them. Just because the spreading of illusions that, like, the Furion can deal. He can do some split push of his own, but he can't really compete with the Naga Siren. It's just so much. Butterfly is going to be his next item. Naga Siren does peek out, though, at a certain point. Like, Naga Siren's great in the late game just because she has many different options. His Phantom Assassin managed to get a kill on the Shadow Demon, backing himself away, Virtus Pro. BKB has now run out, and God unfortunately didn't get the Sleight of Fist Chains combination. And smart play there from Come With Me. Teleports in with the ultimate already activated and slows them down for just enough time for the rest of Virtus Pro to get out, or the rest of Fnatic to get out. Ace. Oh, God, Ace. BKB going to be activated now, trying to get enough distance for his blink. Has it now. Actually, no. Smart little juke there. Very well played. He's actually going to go back into his teammates. Arise. It's Seedoy. And a Ravage will be returned. Refresher. There goes the silence. Seedoy has another Ravage ready to go, and he's great position for it, too. If he could just get it off in a second, Yule Scepter goes down, preventing him from being able to get it off. Furion, meanwhile, comes in from behind with Hani. They're going to go for Come With Me, and Hani decides to cancel his TP to go for BZZ, but already eating through the cheese. Now Hani in some trouble. What an RP, though, from Arise. Catches all four. Hani, does he have enough damage to be able to wipe through it? Sleight of Fist goes out, and they don't. Four, five heroes go down on the side of Fnatic after that beautiful secondary RP from Arise, almost recovering it there. But I don't think the Phantom Assassin had him power. I didn't see that big splash damage coming into play. And unfortunately, unable to finish off the team fight. Three people stay alive on the side of Virtus Pro. And what else are they going to be able to burn on the side of Fnatic? Because they've got BZZ, who, again, that instant punish is already pushing down this top lane. They're going to be able to take the tier 2 most likely. Naga Siren, she was the one buyback. They're trying to hold it to just one buyback here with the Radiant's best split pushing hero. But they may, yeah, they're going to have to blow more. Probably going to have to beat both the Magnus as well as the Phantom Assassin. If they don't want to lose a tier 3, that is. Radiant structures are fortified. Come with me, you can buy back with the ultimate. Here we go. The ultimate is going to be the initiator here. Teleports in. And they've got plenty of time in the world to be able to set this one up. God is going to be side the vine stuff first. Going for BZZ in the background. Able to get that lasso. Stopping the teleport. Beautiful. They're getting these pickoffs. Nobody is really escaping. Seedoy is going to be chased down. The Aegis burned by God. Looks like he'll be able to jump himself away. And Seedoy actually managed to get out there because of a lack of vision. They need some action. Arise. Trying to go for a blind skewer. Gem is actually dropped there on the ground. When was that gem dropped? And why was it dropped? It almost looks like the Ember Spirit dropped it because he's missing a slot, but unless he's going for a straight-up Divine right now, and that's the reason he dropped it, I can't really see why.
He wasn't in trouble, so it's not like he thought he was gonna die.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Still though, Fnatic, I mean, they spread that out decently well. The biggest problem was they let Sidoe get out. I don't think they really could have locked down God well enough in order to catch him on that second life. So instead, they split themselves off and went for Sidoe. Problem is, they didn't have the vision. And Sidoe was able to get away. And I think that was one of the kills that they should have gotten. Still, though, they blew a lot of buybacks here. Right? I'm not sure about them pushing in. Pushing in while the Furion is down, definitely. And at the very least, getting this tier 2. But from here, they got to back out. They got to just buy time. Next 4 minutes, they're at a serious disadvantage. Control the map, split push, stay away from Virtus Pro, because a pick off on a Phantom Assassin or a Naga Siren here in the next minute or two could be devastating. Mirana ultimates. Mirana's got a halberd. Okay, what other items do we actually have? Mjolnir, MKB, double Daedalus. So, secondary Daedalus for the Ember Spirit. No Divine Rapier. I was hoping to see it, man. What happened, God? Shiva's for Sidoe, which you already knew. Yol adds a Fury Blade. On the side of Come With Me's got Butterfly. We've also got double Scythe of Ice for Rise. And our Phantom Assassin, who's pretty much full slotted. I mean, you can remove Mask of Madness for another item if you want. But there's not really an item that gives you that much attack speed.
One horn will do the damage of two.
And even if you did, you need to not only sell the Mask of Madness and replace it with a better item, but also make sure you still have buyback gold for when your buyback is back up. Which is in 3 minutes' time. 3 minutes' time, maybe exactly when Roshan's going to be happening. BKB, ace. Gonna be able to grab BZZ. Starts pulling it back. Sidoe is gonna pursue. He's got a Ravage. He's gonna use the first one on ace. And it looks like the rest of Fnatic are not actually gonna pursue that. And I'm not surprised at all. I don't know why they would actually try and go for that kind of pickoff. Because they know buybacks are down. It doesn't really make sense for them to be aggressive unless they know they have a great pickoff. Virtus Pro looking to take down the last tier 2 on the side of Fnatic.
Radiant's top tower is under
shouldn't
attack.
Have any issues. And unfortunately, Fnatic are in a
Radiant's
pretty poor position. I know they wanted to sit back and make sure that they didn't get picked off. Unfortunately, that paranoia leads them into sitting in a bad position where Virtus Pro are pushing in. Because they don't have these other lanes split pushing, which is supposed to be the advantage of the Naga Siren. Those other lanes aren't actually threatening anything in return for this push. BZZ comes in. Whoa, Jesus. There goes the Skywrath Mage, and there goes BZZ. A very, very fair trade with Come With Me now initiated with the ultimate here. Nature's Prophet's going to buy back. Come With Me. Not sure if that's the fight you wanted, friend. He's going to start backing himself up. Arise actually pushes BZZ into the base with Hani there ready to go. Disruption not going to be enough to save him. He's now going to move on to Sidoe here. Popping the BKB, no double Ravage will stop him. And the rest of Virtus Pro will back themselves up. BKB's activated. RP on two there. That's beautiful. If they can finish up God here during this last of timing, they will be able to. And also gets Jotam on the side, dropping that gem. And this time it's Virtus Pro, who have a terrible, terrible team play. They have two different heroes, namely the Furion, who have no buyback. And down for 90 seconds. That's going to be at least a tier 2. I think that may even be at least a Rax. One lane of Rax here without Virtus Pro contesting. They're probably going to have to buy back on the Tidehunter as well as the Ember Spirit. And they probably will try and go for a team fight with that double Ravage, Sleight of Fist. But it's at a risk. And they may just give up a lane first. That's not a good start. Yul has just been found by Ace. Ethereal Blade going out. Disruption just delaying for time here while the Naga Siren pushes in the middle lane. Double buybacks coming out. Yul still being chased down, but that's very minimal compared to what could be happening here. Lasso, jump in. God has actually been caught out. Hani able to take him down with the BKB. Before the double Ravage could come into play, now it's just left the Tidehunter by himself. Finally, Shatter Demon is going to be going down here in this bottom lane, but I think this is actually over. Fnatic are going to be able to take so much. They have one last team fight, which is going to be with Tidehunter and the Furion. No Ember Spirit. And that's still not going to be happening for another 15 seconds, and they're going to claim so much during that time. So it looks like they may actually be able to get full-out Mega Creeps before the Furion's up. Come with me, just left with one last Ranged Rax. Bottom Ranged Rax, Melee Rax is already down. That's it, Mega Creeps are up. Virtus Pro. Hanging on by just a thread, and it's going to be all about the double Ravage and what PZZ can do during that small amount of time. Jump in. Ravage number one goes out. Ace actually doesn't get caught by it. Ravage number two now going out. They're going to focus on Hani first, but now Ace is able to actually grab BZZ. Hani turns around, goes for it. RP onto Seedoy, and Hani's just looking for any target to lifesteal off of at this point. Jumping on Seedoy, BZZ running out. Couldn't finish off. Come with me, and that's the game right there. So Fnatic, after a very, very tough loss in game number one, up against Virtus Pro, where they lost 20,000 gold in the space of 2 minutes. Game number two, they hold on to much better. And are able to tie up this two-game series. So neither team is really going to be happy with the outcome of this series, as both of them still retain their bottom three position, with Virtus Pro now sitting at 4-5, and Fnatic now being 3-5. Or excuse me, 4-9 on Virtus Pro, 3-5 on Fnatic. So both of them are still sitting in the bottom three. Of course, Fnatic still have three more series to go, and Virtus Pro still have two more, so they have plenty of options left, but it's going to be a close one for them if they hope to stay in the Dota 2 Champions League. That's going to be it for the night go, though, guys. We only have the 1-2 game series. We're going to be back tomorrow. Tomorrow starting at 11 CEST, we'll be starting up joinDOTA Red for the MSI Beat It Asia Pacific part of the tournament. We still have the quarterfinals to go through, so that means we're going to have teams like Rave and some of the best Korean teams facing up against each other. So if you want to join me for that, I'll be casting. And then we also have the ISO Cup starting at 19 CEST, as well as the Dota 2 Champions League with Fnatic versus PR. So a decent amount of Dota tomorrow, going to be pretty much all day long. So if you guys want to join me for that, it'll be all on joinDOTA Red, a little bit on Daily Motion. And for now, guys, thanks so much for tuning in. We'll see you guys next time on the live stream.